final speaker for this morning is a very long-standing collaborator of mine, Ian Thompson. And so there's a few of us who are not as young as we wish we were that go back to the very, very early days of social environmental accounting. And the difficulty of last year is we also lost the founder to social environmental accounting, Rob Gray, in the same year. He died in the June. And so that was a very sort of tough year in any event. And it really sort of brought us all back to the times in the 1990s when we first met and when we, as a group of us, started collaborating together in various combinations. And so I'm thinking Brendan O'Dwyer, who we'll hear from later on today, Carlos Larrañaga, who I know is on the connection as well, Ian Thompson, myself, and Jeffrey as well. And so we saw each other a lot over the years, and some of the pictures in your program are from the one on the top right-hand side was indeed from a 1997 conference when we were all just starting to get to know each other and we all look very young. And my most delightful PhD student just told me earlier on she was 3 when this was taken. So that sort of tells you that time invested makes outcomes, which is really great. So Ian, may I invite you to come and provide some reflections from the Centre for Social Environmental Accounting Research.
Thanks everyone. It really is my kind of privilege, it's not this morning, it's this afternoon though, isn't it? To pay tribute to a real star of the CSER network. One of whom, Dave Owen, who many of you may know, was one of the Anton Deck of social environmental accounting. This was in no way meant to be derogatory, but rather captured their enthusiasm, insights, and passion in new ways of thinking about a topic, which was seen as a really welcome change from the grumpy older men and women who had actually kind of started it off. One of the great kind of joys I found was actually discovering that Jeffrey was older than me, having kind of existed for about 20 years thinking he was younger than me. So again, a bit of a Peter Pan in this field as well. But Dave, in the same conversation to me, marked them out as future intellectual leaders of the field and of the CSER network. Just for a little bit of balance, Dave also said in the same thing, he said, if academic accounting didn't work out for me, I always had a career in stand-up, which was kind of quite encouraging for your research from an eminent professor at the time. But I think he was wrong about me, but he certainly wasn't with Jeffrey and the mystery deck, who I'm going to keep that person surprised. Jeffrey played a heroic role in building CSER from what was a small, tight-knit network, initially focused on disrupting the kind of the mainstream academic and practice. And he moved it from that tight, disruptive network into a global movement. A global movement which now has an active community of 900 scholars across every single continent that you can get. And it's growing. It's a global movement that's now respected by the critical and the mainstream, and as we heard, from practice as well. A significant kind of transition that I think many people wouldn't have thought was possible to actually to do that. It is worth pointing out that CSER, even though we've got all these things, we've got no money. We get a little bit membership. Virtually everything, 99% of what we do is voluntary. It's effectively people choosing to act for a purpose with no ostensible reward and sometimes derision, certainly in the early stages where it's like, you're involved with CSER, why are you doing that? But people persevered. And in many ways, as the kind of the convener of the council, it's humbling to witness this massive collaborative effort and what is effectively a self-organizing network. And today I want to try and do justice to Jeffrey's decades of work in this regard, but I won't be able to do it all. I think it would, I don't know how long it would take to actually to document everything. Now, I will not pretend that I always agreed with Jeffrey. And I know that he didn't always agree with me. How did I know that? Am I a mind reader? No, he told me. When he didn't agree with you, he told you. not to pick a fight, not to grandstand, not to platform, because but of a kind of a genuine concern with the topic or the network. He cared about genuinely and respectfully engaging in scientific conversations as a productive dialogue, not false platitudes or storming off in a huff when things don't go your own way, which we all know is a really attractive kind of thing to do, the theatrical, oh, I'm not staying for any more of this. But he kind of learned an awful lot of how you kind of doing things. He was able to separate robust scientific argument from personal relationships. And that insight was essential to building the community. Productive engagement and dialogue. Saying everything is great doesn't work. Neither does disagreeing with everything. There's a middle ground. Productive engagement, collaboration, partnership, respect. And these are things Geoffrey embodied and things he embedded in Caesar. It was great fun to argue with Geoffrey. It was really, really good fun. He was quick, insightful, politically aware, incredibly well read, but always had a concern about making change happen, making things better, a pragmatic concern that actually kind of didn't let perfect get in the way of better. He understood about transition. He understood about how to kind of to build things. And it's very much his philosophy that was, we mustn't let our differences divide us or define us, but actually our similarities unite us. Now that's a valuable lesson to someone like me who is instinctively oppositional. It really is my kind of thing. But it also is a lesson that's kind of like key to building a community. Geoffrey also opened up a southern front, the southern trenches in that London, the home of imperialism, where the dreaded market existed. Up until that point, Caesar had largely been a little bit peripheral, marginal, northern, like in all its regard, pointing the finger down at them. Geoffrey lived there. He kind of embedded so much about, I learned so much about London around there. He became the southern rallying point, if you like, in that space, and instrumental in building the community south of the Watford Gap. We had many a fun discussion about where civilization started and stopped, and many of those kind of Geoffrey's things. He also, alongside Lyndon Lewis, a lot of people don't necessarily remember when you look at Geoffrey's work, he was one of the first to seriously investigate the role of the internet and digital. He shifted us from analog to digital in a way. And he was first really person to actually do a serious study on the impact of this. And that was his first work, which again, I think people have said in terms of his longer term vision on seeing where things, his ability to future. Now there's a little story about this, which I'll go. And I'm sure Brendan O'Dwyer is going to take, will remember. The three of us decided we'd go to the Irish Accounting and Finance Conference in Galway, largely because Brendan was from Galway and it said it's a brilliant place to go. It'll be an absolute great crack. And so we thought, okay, let's go. But to be honest, me and Brendan were a little bit worried about how Geoffrey's going to go down. I mean, he definitely had he's got the poshest English accent I've kind of thought of any of my friends, right? And he's definitively English. You know, you can't really argue. You don't say, you know, it's like, oh, Geoffrey, where are you from? you got that sort of like right away. And he's walking into this, you know, this rebel kind of like hotbed of kind of like Western Ireland sitting there. And at the time, social and environmental planning was not the traditional fare of the Irish Accounting and Finance Institute. So we thought, oh, well, he's a big boy, he'll do it. So anyway, so Geoffrey kind of walked into the front, stood there, and he sort of said, hello, I'm kind of Geoffrey. I can't do his accent, sorry, I wouldn't even try. And I'm going to do this thing on corporate social responsibility on the internet. Perfect pause. And he goes, now, if you don't know what the internet is, I believe it'll be coming to you soon. Right? Oof, and exactly that. There was laughter, there was ice broken, and a memorable 3 days emerged. But that was that kind of thing, that confronting the kind of the challenge. And just to let you know, Caesar Island had its third conference with 176 people attending from that very kind of small thing. And Jeffrey was invited back more than once to go and talk to them there. He was a master of the art of being quietly critical, making points, powerful insights, deeply informed by theory, but without appearing to be critical or needing to resort to political polemics or pantomimes. Preaching to the converted was not his style. He didn't see the point. He could polemicize with the best of them, but in private. He was not a natural revolutionary, but he changed things. He built bridges. In Caesar, he was very much the rebuilder of bridges that had been broken as part of the creative destruction process that's often necessary for any kind of radical transformation. And it's a much harder job than it sounds, but it's really important. And I know for many of us involved there, that was not our strength. And to be honest, still love a little bit creative destruction. You kind of get in there, you do that. The problem with creative destruction, as a consequence, you're left with broken pieces that need to be put back together. And you need people to put them back together. And Jeffrey instinctively moved to that space. Nobody said, can you do that? He knew that was actually the part to do it. He recognized the need and got on with it. Much of it was backstage out of the public limelight. He was reaching out to existing allies inside and outside Caesar, engaging with whoever needed reform. He didn't see the profession or practitioners as a monolithic, all-powerful enemy who slavishly worshipped at the altar of neoliberalism. But he rather saw them as a conflicted, complex assemblage of individuals and institutions. Many of them were experiencing the same amount of oppression that other businesses and other people were actually feeling. He had communities that were struggling to do the right thing, or didn't know what the right thing was to do, okay? He also recognized that there was some in there who were vehemently opposed to any social and environmental accounting reform. His great insight was that this last group was a minority, and it was about seeking allies elsewhere. And it was all too easy and had fallen into the trap of conflating the vocal opposition to social and environmental accounting reforms and neoliberal propagandists with the profession. His great gift was that these shock jocks were actually a minority, and to see beyond them with the people who wanted to change and you could actually work with. And his approach really contained tactics about engaging with the "we'd like to do something but don't know what to do" by telling them what they could do as what they should do as well. And he was actually able to recreate bits of Caesar as a home, if you like, for people who wanted to do things, where you had also people who were marginalized in other communities. And to do this, his approach was highly effective, and he was also acutely sensitive of culture and context. He started from, as the Americans say, where people are at, not from the Irish. Well, if that's where you're going, you wouldn't be starting from here. Okay, where are we? What can we do? I remember conversations when we had in sort of like first kind of group of people from China, mainland China, coming to Caesar conferences, and they would present papers, which, you know, to be honest, were rubbish, right? And we were going, oh, look at that, they're rubbish. And Jeffrey pointed out, no, they're not rubbish. What they're doing is they're doing normal science properly. That they've been reading the articles, they've been following the kind of trends, and they've been kind of like emulating and replicating it. We shouldn't criticize them for doing that just because it's different. Our responsibility is to engage and to nudge and to move them forward and to make things better, not to criticize or dismiss. He was also the kind of Caesar's bridge to institutional opportunity to other communities, got access to grants, identified change in regulations and standards as opportunities to influence change. And it's really hard to underestimate the time, persistence, long, hard kind of job that is, poring over rules and regulation, keeping abreast of possible interventions, reading minutes, following up meetings, responding to drafts and consultations. This is very much the unglamorous hard yards of accounting engagement. It's quite ironic doing a sporting metaphor for Jeffrey. I just realised that I've done that. I remember we had a competition one time in a bar, and we said, how many players are in a rugby team, football team, and rugby union team and cricket? And he got one right, which is, anyway. in some ways, the ritualistic academic arena was important, but he kind of saw it as too disconnected to make a difference. And I was really fortunate to witness Jeffrey's skill in this regard, his work on the Caesar Council, where for years he displayed his many leadership skills, hard conversations, coherence with vision, capacity building, intelligent negotiation and attention to detail. His work at transforming the Social, Environmental and Accountability Journal from an informative newsletter to a fully fledged peer-reviewed scientific journal, which still kept the essence of the original communication, was testament to all these skills. Not only that, he set it up, but then he then took it on and did the work as editor. So it's all very easy to say, oh, they do this. He actually went in and he did it. And he's actually kind of, again, not just got the vehicle of SEAG, but actually he then set the tone and that kind of transformation, which is now a journal, a recognized journal in its own right, and a key kind of like publication in our network. He contributed to CSER as a research innovator and leader. He was a gifted researcher and social scientist whose work remains an inspiration and a blueprint for others to emulate. He was able to apply different theories and different methods intelligently, but also humbly recognize their limitations. What really got him annoyed was poorly done research, not different theories or different methods. If it was like, just do the job properly. He could pathologically dissect papers, and I've been on the other end of that pathological dissection on a number of times. But he rarely did it in public, and he virtually never did it in public with early career researchers. As well as appreciating his lively workshop paper presentations at various CSER conferences, his masterful plenary performances. My abiding memory was not Jeffrey in front of a microphone here. It would be when you came out for coffee, he'd be sitting quietly with somebody who just presented a paper, and he'd be like scribbling down wee notes, quietly, privately having conversations with this kind of this person about how maybe kind of constructively engaging with them, nudging them towards better ways to achieve their research questions, not his or not ours. And I think it put hours in this patient endeavor, helping build the community, creating and arguably saving careers. And I'm sure many of us have benefited from this freely given advice. And looking around the audience, I know people who've had the benefit of those sitting in the corner around the edges, been actually kind of is there. Jeffrey was a powerful advocate for social environmental accounting research in CSER in particular, in his many roles, which we've heard about today, but also as an editor, council member, and also kind of a reviewer in that place. There was decades of hidden community building practices, which will always be in his debt. Now, I don't want to paint this picture of a bureaucratic minded diplomat, nor was he always a peacemaker. When harsh words were needed and difficult decisions to be made, he spoke and he acted, but not in his own interest, but for the bigger picture and vision. He was delightfully mischievous. Still, you kind of like, if you were chairing a session or you were sitting there, there would be a one word, and there'd be a ripple of laughter, and you could just like trace it back to where Jeffrey was sitting and other people were giggling. But he did provide the balance and wise counsel that was needed to grow, create, and mobilize a community. He worked easily alongside the ranters, the silenced, and the marginalized. He constructed our capacity for impact. And for that, we are eternally grateful.